Greetings, fellow humans. In today's video, I want to go over the installation process of Ubuntu 20.04 on VirtualBox. VirtualBox is a tool that allows you to run virtual machines. A virtual machine is a complete, self-contained operating system. You could say that it's like an additional standalone computer within your physical computer. As for the user experience you get, using a virtual machine is extremely similar to using a normal one. So if, for example, you want to familiarize yourself with Linux, VirtualBox is a great way to get your feet wet. By the way, the operating system that runs on the actual physical computer, which is Windows 11 in my case, is called the host, whereas the virtual one, that would be Ubuntu, is called the guest. To download VirtualBox, let's head over to virtualbox.org. And let's click on Download VirtualBox. We need to select Windows hosts. And the installation file is being downloaded. The installation itself is pretty straightforward, so let's go ahead and install it. I'm going to leave everything as it is. Great, VirtualBox is up and running. We now need the Ubuntu ISO file. This file can be used to install Ubuntu either on a physical computer or on a virtual one. To get it, let's head over to ubuntu.com. And under Download, we can see two options for Ubuntu Desktop. One will be the latest LTS version. That's the long-term support release, which is released on April of even years. So there was one in 2018, one in 2020, 2022, and so on. These LTS versions are supported for 5 years. The other option is the latest version overall. This is a short-term support release. Short-term support versions are released twice a year, but are only supported for about 9 months. I'll go with the LTS version. We can see some Ubuntu-related projects to which we can make a donation, and in a few seconds the download itself starts. It's a big file, about 3 GB, so I'll be back once it's done downloading. Okay, the file was downloaded. Let's get back to VirtualBox and create our virtual machine. We're creating a new virtual machine, so let's click on New. Let's name it. Notice that VirtualBox will try to guess the type of the virtual machine you're creating according to the name you type in. But in case it didn't guess correctly, you can always change the selection yourself. As for the folder for the virtual machine, I'll go with the default, but it can be changed. We now need to decide how much RAM is going to be allocated to the virtual machine. Keep in mind that it's a zero-sum game. Whatever you give to the virtual machine won't be available to the Windows host. So try to give the virtual machine a good amount of RAM, but don't give too much and make sure you stay in the green zone. I'll go with about 3.5 GB. We now need to create a virtual disk for the virtual machine. The virtual machine won't have access to the entire physical disk, so we're going to allocate a chunk of it, which is nothing but a file in a special format. And the virtual machine will be confined to this area of the disk. It won't even be aware that there is anything beyond that. We can use an existing virtual disk, but we didn't create any virtual disks yet, so we're going to create a new one. I don't want to get into disk file types, so let's just go with VDI, which is the format that's most compatible with VirtualBox. We can now choose if the disk space for the virtual machine will be allocated up front, or increase during the life of the virtual machine whenever it requires more. I'll go with dynamically allocated. We can name the virtual disk and change its location. By default, VirtualBox will name the virtual disk according to the name you chose for the virtual machine itself, which makes a lot of sense. And we also need to set the size of the virtual disk. If you chose fixed size in the previous step, that's how much will be allocated. And if you chose dynamically allocated, that's the limit to which the virtual disk can grow. 10 GB should be enough for a basic installation of Ubuntu, but it's a bit cramped, so I would suggest to increase it a bit. I'll go with 13 gigabytes. And a virtual machine was created. We have a bit more configuration to do before moving on to the Ubuntu installation. So let's start by clicking on System. And here we can see the amount of RAM we allocated. But if we switch to the Processor tab, we can see that out of the 8 CPUs on my computer, only one is currently allocated to the virtual machine. Ubuntu can work with one processor, but I don't want it to be sluggish, so I'll increase it to 2. Again, make sure you stay away from the red zone. As for the video memory, I'm going to drag it all the way to the right, as it will help the virtual machine to be more responsive. I also want to change the graphics control. And I'll change it to VBox SVGA. This controller allows the virtual machine to change its resolution while running. One last thing we need to do is provide the virtual machine with the Ubuntu ISO file we downloaded. If you're old enough, you might remember the time when CD-ROMs and DVDs were very common, and almost every computer had a CD-ROM drive. Back then, CD-ROMs were how we used to install ISO files. It's not the case anymore, and we mostly use USB flash drives nowadays. But when it comes to virtual machines, CD-ROM drives are still in their prime. If we take a look at storage, we can see that we have an optical drive, and we can see that it's currently empty. This optical drive is a virtual CD-ROM drive. We need to attach our ISO file to this optical drive, and it's equivalent to inserting a CD-ROM containing this ISO file to the CD-ROM drive. So let's insert the ISO file to the optical drive. Okay, we're all set and good to go. Let's go ahead and start the virtual machine, which in turn will start the Ubuntu installation. We're informed that the virtual machine supports keyboard integration and mouse integration. Basically, it means that whenever the window of the virtual machine is active, whatever we do with the mouse and the keyboard is sent over to the virtual machine. We now need to choose if we want to install Ubuntu or just to try it. Let's install it. We can also change our language, but I'll go with English. We now need to choose our keyboard layout. If you're not sure which one to choose, you can type in this text box here to make sure that your keyboard actually generates what you intend to type. We now need to choose if we want normal installation or minimal installation. The difference is that the normal installation comes with a few more software tools, things like an office suite, a video player, and so on. You can go with either, but since my focus in this video is not on these software tools, I'll go with minimal, and I can always install them manually once the installation is done. Let's also download updates while installing and install third-party software. And let's choose Erase Disk and install Ubuntu. You can rest assured that whatever you have on your physical disk will stay intact, since the virtual machine only has access to the virtual disk, which we created a few moments ago. So even though the virtual disk will be formatted, it's completely separated from the actual physical disk. We now need to provide our location. Usually, if your host is connected to the internet, Ubuntu will know where you are, but you can change it and choose any other place. Linux is designed from the ground up as a multi-user system. Whenever you interact with a Linux machine, you do it as a user. So to continue with the installation, we must create a user. First, we need to provide a name for the user. Your full name is a logical choice, but you can go with anything else. We also need to provide the username for this user. That's the name that will actually be used when you use Ubuntu. Your first name should be a good choice, but again, you can go with whatever you want. The installer generated a name for the machine. You can either accept it or change it to your liking. We also need to provide a password for the user. Make sure you write it down somewhere. Forgetting your Linux password can easily lock you out. I'll choose to log in automatically when the system starts. And let's move on. Okay, Ubuntu is being installed. It will take a few minutes, so I'll stop the recording and I'll be back once it's done. Okay, the installation was completed. To start using Ubuntu on our virtual machine, we need to restart it, so let's do that. And we're told that we need to remove the installation medium. So let's open the VirtualBox manager. And we can see that the optical drive is empty again. That's because VirtualBox detached the ISO file from the virtual CD-ROM. So the installation medium was removed and we can continue. And Ubuntu successfully loaded. We can log in to several cloud services, but I'm just going to skip. And I don't want to set up live patch right now. And you can choose if you want to send anonymous data about our usage. Feel free to either participate or not to. We can allow applications to access our location. Again, it's up to you. And we can see some example apps that are available to use with Ubuntu. I don't want anything right now, so let's close it. And we got a message that there are pending updates. So let's install them. Okay, it's done. Right now, the virtual machine doesn't use the entire screen. And you can't really experience how Ubuntu is supposed to look and feel like that. So let's resize the window. And Ubuntu changes its resolution accordingly. We can also enable full screen. And the shortcut for that is Host F. On Windows, the host key is the right control. So let's try it. Right control F. And Ubuntu is now using the entire screen. To get back to the host, we can press right control F once again. Thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.